JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's weekly market outlook webinar for the week November the 1st until November the 5th. I am Charalambos, Pissouros, head of research here at JFD, and I will describe the most important economic releases and events on the financial agenda for the week ahead. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, following the ECB, the Bank of Canada, and the Bank of Japan decisions last week, we have three more major central banks announcing their own policy decisions this week. Those are the RBA, the FOMC, and the Bank of England. We also get the US employment report for October and the Canadian jobs data for the same month. And we also have an OPEC plus gathering where major oil producers will decide on oil output. But let's take things from the beginning. Today is a relatively light day, with the only releases on the agenda worth mentioning being the final market manufacturing PMIs for October from the UK and the US, which are just expected to confirm their preliminary estimates. We also have the ISM manufacturing index for the month, which is forecast to have declined somewhat to 60.5 from 61.1. Now on Tuesday, during the Asian session, meaning tonight, the first central bank decision of the week will be announced, and this will be from the RBA. Last month, policymakers of this bank kept all their policy settings unchanged and repeated that they will continue to purchase government securities at the current pace until at least mid-February. And they also maintained the view that interest rates are unlikely to rise before 2024. That's the most important point, conditional upon what happened after that meeting. Now, according to the ASX 30-day interbank cash rate futures yield curve, recently market participants have raised bets that interest rates could start rising at some point in the middle of next year. And following last week's acceleration in underlying inflation metrics, they now even see the benchmark rate hitting 1.25% by the end of next year. So, although the RBA has pointed to unchanged rates until 2024, market pricing points to aggressive rate hikes even as soon as next year. And another point of interest is that on Friday, the RBA declined to defend its bond yield target, which may have been a signal that it now intends to tighten monetary policy much faster than previously thought. So, although we don't expect any policy change at this gathering, we will pay extra attention to the accompanying statement to see whether the forward guidance on interest rates has changed or not. Now, in our view, the risks surrounding the Aussie's reaction, though, are tilted to the downside. Even if officials signal that they now expect to start lifting rates next year, they may not match market bets on subsequent hikes. The market is already very, very hawkish, and this leaves ample room for a disappointment. Now, as for Tuesday's data, we have Eurozone's final manufacturing PMI and Switzerland's CPI, both for October. On Wednesday, the central bank torch will be passed to the FOMC. When they last met, US policymakers kept their policy untouched as well, but in the statement accompanying the decision, it was noted that if progress continues broadly as expected, the committee judges that a moderation in the pace of asset purchases may soon be warranted. What's more, The new dot plot pointed to 9 members in favor of rate increases to start next year and 17 supporting higher rates in 2023. Remember that back in June, the respective numbers were 7 and 13. Now, since the previous meeting, several policymakers have been adding fuel to expectations over a November tapering start, while the better-than-expected earnings results suggested that the U.S. economy was not affected by the latest bottlenecks, as many may have believed. This, combined with the fact that inflation continued to accelerate in September, well above the Fed's objective of 2%, I think it went to 5.4%, allowed market participants to consider the tapering start at this meeting as a done deal, while they brought forth their bets with regards to the first interest rate hike. According to the yields of the Fed Fund futures, market participants are now nearly fully pricing in and 25 basis points hike to be delivered in August 2022. Remember that a few weeks ago, such a move was expected in the first months of 2023. So with all that in mind, we do expect the committee to begin tapering this week. And given that, at the prior press conference, Chair Powell noted that a gradual tapering process could conclude around the middle of next year, we expect a pace of $20 billion. Now, given that the tapering is largely anticipated by the financial community, all the attention is likely to follow the statement accompanying the decision and Powell's press conference for comments on inflation and hints on interest rates. Anything suggesting that inflation could stay elevated for longer than previously anticipated and that interest rates could start rising soon after the tapering is over, this whole thing could support the US dollar. The opposite may be true in case policymakers try to push back against interest rate pricing, against market expectations over interest rates. Now, as for the rest of Wednesday's events, during the Asian session, we do get New Zealand's employment report for the third quarter. The unemployment rate is forecast to have slipped to 3.9% from 4%, but the employment change is expected to have slowed to 0.4% quarter over quarter from 1%. That said, the labor cost index is anticipated to have risen to 2.6% year over year from 2.2%, which combined with a downtick in the unemployment rate could paint a relatively positive picture. So following the RBNZ's decision to hike rates at its latest meeting and signal that further removal of policy stimulus is expected over time, and this end report could strengthen the case for more rate hikes by the RBNZ and thereby prove positive for the Kiwi. Now, Japanese markets will stay closed on Wednesday due to the Culture Day, while from China we get the Kaijin Services PMI for October, but for which no forecast is available. Later in the day, we have the final market services and composite PMIs for October from the UK and the US, as well as the ISM non-manufacturing index for the month. The final market prints are expected to confirm their initial estimates, while the ISM index is anticipated to have increased to 62.1 from 61.9. Now, on Thursday, it's the turn of the Bank of England to decide on monetary policy. Back in September, this bank kept all its policy settings unchanged as well, but in the statement accompanying the decision, it appeared very confident on interest rate increases. Officials noted that some developments have strengthened the case of some modest tightening over the forecast period, and added that this should come in the form of a rate hike, even if that becomes appropriate before the quantitative easing end. Now, recent data show that inflation in the UK slowed more than anticipated in September, but with both the headline and the core rates staying well above the Bank of England's objective of 2%, this may have allowed market participants to keep pricing over a rate hike very soon. What's more, Governor Andrew Bailey and MPC member Michael Sanders have expressed willingness to push the hike button very soon, and all this prompted market participants to assign an 18, according to the overnight index swaps forward yield curve, to assign an 80% chance for a 15 basis points hike to take place at this gathering. Therefore, a 15 basis points hike by itself given that it is largely priced in, is unlikely to move the pound much. We believe that if indeed the bank lifts rates, market participants will quickly turn their attention to the statement, the meeting minutes, the bank's updated economic projections, and also, but also on the voting over a hike. The decision was a close call. The language and projections point to a slower rate path than the overnight index swaps curve suggests, then the pound could pull back. There is also a chance that due to the recent supply shortages in the UK that appear to have left their marks on the economy, officials refrain from hitting the hike button now, and perhaps wait until next month, a decision that could result in a stronger sell-off in the pound. Now, our view for the pound to keep strengthening, the Bank of England may have to appear more optimistic than the current market pricing suggests. In other words, it has to deliver a hike and signal that more are on the cards in the months to come. So overall, we see the risks surrounding the pound's reaction to the meeting as tilted to the downside. Elsewhere, we have Australia's trade balance and retail sales for September and the third quarter, respectively, as well as Eurozone's finance services and composite PMIs for October. Now, finally, on Friday, the main item on the agenda may be the US employment report for October. Non-farm payrolls are expected to have rebounded to 413,000 after falling to 194,000 in September, while the unemployment rate is expected to have ticked down to 4.7% from 4.8%. Average hourly earnings are expected to have slowed somewhat on a monthly basis to 0.4% from 0.6%, but the year-over-year rate is forecast to have risen to 4.9% from 4.6%. Now, overall, the numbers point to a decent report in our view, but how the market will respond may be conditional upon the FOMC decision. If indeed the Fed signals that inflation could stay elevated for longer than they have previously assumed, and that could lead to rates rising sooner, and a good employment report could add credence to that view and allow some more US buying. However, the big question is, how will the stock market respond? Will it slide due to expectations of faster rate hikes, which could hurt profitability of firms? Or will it rise on signs that the US economy is performing better than many may have recently feared due to the latest supply shortages? In our view, although the former has been the case in the past, we believe that lately it's been the latter. So we expect decent jobs data to help stocks drift further north. Now, at the same time with the US NFPs, we get the employment report for October from Canada as well. Expectations are for the unemployment rate to have slid to 6.8% from 6.9%, but for the net change in employment to show that the economy has added fewer jobs than in September. With the Bank of Canada unexpectedly ending its quantitative easing program last week, officials are now scratching their heads on when the appropriate time for a rate increase maybe. The financial world anticipates such a move early next year. And in our view, a slowdown in jobs growth for just a month is unlikely to change that, especially if the unemployment rate indeed slides, as the forecast suggests. Therefore, we believe that the Canadian dollar will stay largely linked to oil prices, and the next event considering the energy market is the gathering between the OPEC Plus group, which is scheduled for Thursday. That said, the official outcome could become public on Friday. Now, although the group is under pressure from the US to increase supply, several members appear unwilling to do so, with one of the latest headlines pointing to Algeria saying that output should not exceed the current agreement of 400,000 barrels per day because of market uncertainty and risks. Therefore, the base case scenario is for no change, which is unlikely to affect oil prices much. In our view, it will just allow the current uptrend to slowly continue. For oil prices to slide notably, the group may need to surprise the markets by announcing an increase in its quotas. There is also chatter that they may double production in November, but keep it unchanged in December. However, we don't see this as a material change, and we don't and we would expect any effect, if any, on oil prices to be temporary. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. I hope you have a great week, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again next Monday. If you are interested in more detailed and frequent analysis, you can find me on our YouTube channel from Tuesday to Friday at around 9 o'clock a.m. GMT. So goodbye, have a nice day, and a greater week.
JFT, just fair and direct.